from the beautiful island of Penang, Raymond Tan against Brianata Rosadhi. And straight away, Rosadhi wants to take it to where we figure
out. Oh, he's in on a really tight guillotine, though. This could be the beginning of the end. That's a really deep, deep, deep guillotine that Tan has in. I think this is going to be
it. Could be over very quickly.
This is very, very tight. He's out. He's out. He's out.
He's out. He's not going to be able to tap. Now he's gone. Well, my goodness me. It's all over so quickly. Still unconscious referee Kenichi Serizawa looking to bring him round. He'll be fine. But my goodness me, he went to take it downstairs and immediately fell into Raymond Tan's trap.
Well, you know, a guy like Raymond Tan, we talked about, he has very long limbs. He's built for triangles and for arm bars and for chokes because those longer, thinner arms, you know, they're really easy to get underneath your opponent's neck. And that's exactly what happened here as Rosadhi went for that takedown. Tan was able to just sink that arm in and sink that choke in, and it was beautiful right from the get-go. Yeah, and as soon as Rosadhi went for that takedown, Tan had a guillotine in, and that's actually a modified guillotine too when you start pushing up on the bottom of your hand. And that's in so deep that sometimes you don't even feel it. You're cutting off the carotid arteries and the blood flow, and you see a referee's all over the action. But good night, Irene, to take a page out of Chiavello's book there.
Well, there he is. Rosadhi is standing up and clearly has recovered. But what a devastating loss that is for him in front of his home fans as well.
Ladies and gentlemen, referee Kenichi Serizawa calls a halt to this bout at 21 seconds of the very first round for your winner via submission, via guillotine choke, from the blue corner, Raymond Tan!
Home fans looking to see how emphatically he can finish this one after seeing their compatriot lose the first fight of the night. He's enjoying himself. Look at the smile on his face, Metino.
That's good. You know, being confident and being comfortable is really important when you're in the cage there. A lot of times guys use a lot of energy, be intense. Sophy is going to be happy. He's keeping the fight upright here and using that reach to his advantage, trying to exploit the weaknesses here. And
good left hand from Metino, landed right on the jaw of the Cambodian. Very accurate. Looking to flick out that jab. He's still got that smile on his face.
Sophy's being very flat-footed, good angles, good footwork. You know, when you're facing someone who's a southpaw versus orthodox, you want to circle outside of their lead foot so you don't go into that power hand. You saw Metino there switching up his base.
He's changing his stance, isn't he? He's still smiling.
So Sophy looks a little bit hesitant here to get anything going. I think he's afraid he might open up that takedown.
Just ate a nice little left jab there from Sophy.
And there's that takedown. Sophy wants to get his back to the cage here, and he does not want to be flat on the ground. Tino's doing a good job of controlling him. Sophy needs to push away and forget holding on to Metino here, and start to work his way back up. Oh, he moves into mount. This could be the beginning of the end. Sophy's in a lot of trouble here. You see a lot of strikers do this. They'll try to hold on to a guy when he's in mount and try to stall him out a little bit. That just shows really kind of an inexperience with being on your back. Metino's gonna look to set up that arm bar. See him working his knees up nice and high. And what Sophy's doing there is just kind of stalling out Metino by holding on to him and keeping his posture down so that Metino can't stand up and rain down any punches. Sophy needs to get his hands off of Metino's waist and start pushing on his hips, creating some space. Just really needs to figure out a way to create some space here, else Max is going to be able to constantly rain down punches. Elbows to the head. Metino's going to just try to soften him up here and then look for that armbar. Sophy's got to be careful. If you keep extending those arms up towards Max's head, he's going to give him the armbar, like right here. That's in pretty deep. Can he slide out? Oh, he's out. Nice double leg attempt. Good back and forth action. Metino is able to get that double leg and just drive through. Passes to cross side. You know, that's another part about this whole ground game is if you miss those submission attempts, you're giving up that position and you're creating that scramble where you have a very dominant position and you can throw some punches. You have to be very, very conscious because it's always a risk factor when you go for a submission. If you miss it, you give up that dominant position, you might have to fight again. Metino doing a good job here of just controlling the cross side action. Sophy really needs to get something going here. He's just kind of holding on to the end of the round. Has about 20 seconds left. But even just holding on there, that still gives Metino the ability to start setting up submissions by extending your arms. Ideally, when you're on your back like that, you want to protect your arms and you want to get off your back, try to face your opponent. But with 10 seconds left, it looks like he's going to survive to the next round. You take a look here at the action in the round. Nice jab set up the double leg by Metino. Drove it through, and this was much of the action that we ended up seeing. Eventually, Metino was able to move into mount on Sophy, and Sophy really didn't have an answer. He went for that armbar here, and it gave Sophy a little bit of space to get to his knees. Sweat's a huge factor. Allows your opponent to pull out, and allows us to go to round two. Metino looks like his game plan is just to stay on with what he's been doing. Setting up a takedown with the punches. And if you're Sophy's corner at this point, you have to think that you want to keep utilizing that jab. Start to throw some knees or some uppercuts to really mix up the levels and make Metino miss some of those takedowns, be a little more hesitant. Because if Metino's confident on changing levels and taking you down, it's going to make for a long night. You see Sophy trying to bait, I'm sorry, Metino trying to bait Sophy into throwing punches there to open him up for the takedown. Metino just having a good time looking to set those punches up, get that takedown in there. He's got to be careful though when he throws that leg and just kind of lands lazy. If Sophy lets his hands go and puts together some combinations. Sophy really needs to get going here though. He's being very, very pensive. Nice leg kick. There's that double leg again. Sophy really doesn't have an answer to it. He's grabbing that front headlock. Wrestlers call that a cow catcher. They can look for submissions and the guillotines, but definitely an area that Sophy has to work on here is going to be his grappling and his wrestling. Otherwise, he's not going to really be able to exploit the striking. Metino Metino's starting to get Sophy in a crucifix position here. He's trapping Sophy's far arm with his head and his shoulder. And he's using his hips to keep the weight across his chest here, and that's going to really open up a lot of those strikes. Oh, this is a bad position for Sophy to be in here. He can't really defend himself intelligently from this position. He's got to try to get his right arm back, create a little bit of space here. This is a position Matt Hughes made very dominant. He fought BJ Penn, Hoyce Gracie. This is a very, very bad position here for Sophy.
Move.
A lot of punishment here. Sophy needs to do something, or a referee is going to come in. He's given him fair warning that he needs to protect himself.
The pace starting to tell on both of these fighters now. Halfway through the contest, Sophy using those knees, battering them into the shoulder of the Indonesian.
Well, you know, one of the things that I have to say is that Metino's been in a very dominant position but hasn't really been able to put enough mustard on those punches to finish the fight. He may look for a submission here. Yeah, he's starting to work that far side key lock. There we go. That's it.
Kenichi Serizawa was poised to stop that seconds before he actually did. But once it happened, this crowd really responded, and Sophy is walking around the cage saying, no, there's no way. I didn't lose that one. I'm still ready to fight. But Serizawa was poised, and he made his decision, and Indonesia have a winner here in Jakarta. Gets us off to a nice start, but Sophy is distraught over there. What's your view on this, Jason?
Well, he did exactly what he needed to do. He took the grappler side of his game and he executed it, took the striker down, was able to control, set up the key lock, just beautifully executed.
Well, Sophie's still remonstrating over there in the far corner, looking really, really miffed. Oh, he's just punched the canvas. Really frustrated he is.
Ladies and gentlemen, referee Kenichi Serizawa calls a halt to this bout at 3 minutes, 24 seconds of round number two for your winner via submission from the red corner, Max Ombak Metino!
This fight brought to you by Bachelora.com, and they're straight into it, and Yang gets caught with a big right hand but keeps training and lands a good right of his own, and the American is under pressure.
That was a blitzkrieg right
really
out of the
was.
Gate. You know, some guys like to kind of come out with a slow pace, feel you out. Some guys come out of the gate, guns a-blazing. You know, both have their strategies.
You could tell the way Yang approached the preliminaries that he was really going to start quickly, and that he did.
You know, I used to start quickly like that, but it was usually because I was terrified. I wish I was kidding.
There may be an element of that involved here.
Well, sometimes, you know, you feel like going out there and being aggressive and getting in someone's face, it's the best way to get that those nerves out, because you get hit a couple times and you settle into your rhythm.
Knee to the torso from Fodor.
He trades.
Oh, Tommy comes in with a good right hand. The left was a little high.
This is very evenly matched so far.
Enjoying what we're seeing here in Jakarta. Fiery start from these two.
Absolutely. You just have to be careful, though, when you come out of the gate with such tenacity that you're not going to use up all of your energy up front. You see those underhooks being worked by Tommy there. And Caros wants to get his arms back inside too. That's good head position, head on the chin, just like that. You know, it's one of the things you can't really appreciate is how technical you have to be up against the cage unless you've trained mixed martial arts. Sometimes it looks arbitrary as far as where the athletes are putting their hands or their head, but everything has a very specific purpose to it. Whether it's blocking a knee, Tommy looks like he's trying to get in here on a single leg.
The elbow there. I think looking for the ear, the right side of Tommy's face. Don't forget, no matter how good Fodor is, Tommy Young is unbeaten. And you do not want to lose that unbeaten record. That's perhaps why he's so fired up.
There's also a lot of pressure on you when you have that. He's in on a front headlock.
Well, this will be a test for him. Gets out of it. Fodor perhaps gave up the position.
Tommy's looking for that takedown. He keeps dropping down to get in on that single leg. But Caros is very, very, very comfortable training with guys like Demetrius Johnson and Bibiano Fernandez with takedowns off the cage. So he knows how to defend that.
Right hand from Fodor. Connected strongly, and he likes those knees, doesn't he? With the hand around the head, bringing the body in, working that right hand very well to head and body. Now Carlos going for the double leg.
Nice takedown. The guys like Randy Couture really are big advocates of the double leg in mixed martial arts over a single leg. Control the hips a little bit more, getting a little bit deeper on the penetration. You see the difference there. Tommy had three single leg attempts. Now Carlos doing a good job of working from guard here. He's gonna try to posture up, create some space to really rain down punches. Gotta be careful of the arm here.
Big points for the takedown, of course. Don't forget that 1FC rules dictate that scoring is on the fight as a whole, not round by round, 3 5-minute rounds here. 1.5 minutes left in the first.
You see how Caros is using his right knee underneath Tommy's right knee. That just helps position his hips so that he's going to try to work his top leg out and try not to get into Tommy's guard when he passes, just like that. Uh-oh.
That looks
deep,
very
Kimura.
Bad.
That's pretty deep. If he can step his left leg over his head to get a little more pressure,
oh,
just like
he's
that.
He's done that.
This is it. Oh, Tommy's.
He's saying, no, I'm not tapping, referee. But he's got a big job on to maintain that status.
But Tommy's got to be careful here because that straight armbar is difficult to get from that position, but he's very isolated. And he's going to give Caros a bunch of different options here. He's going to look for a Kimura. He's going to look for the Americana, key lock.
Tommy has 40 seconds to fight this off, and it looks as if he may have achieved the greater part of it.
That was a very close submission.
Getting a round of applause here at cage side from a very knowledgeable crowd.
You see, that's exactly what you want to do when you're on your side there, when you're on your back like Tommy's doing, is using his left hand to protect and get underneath.
The right hand and the left, and that head bouncing off the canvas. The double whammy, if you like. 10 seconds, and what a round it's been. From the spectator's point of view, fantastic that both men have survived it and that we'll see a second round.
It's a great round, even from the commentator's point of view.
Happy with that.
You know, there's nothing I like better than guys getting out there, planting their feet, and just kind of saying, let's just exchange in the middle here. Let's figure out where this goes. Only problem with that is it kind of becomes a coin flip a little bit. Anderson Silva was key with that. We'll see some of that action here right away.
I think this was at the very beginning.
Right back, left and right. You see Carlos trying to work a couple of uppercuts in there, but Tommy just swinging for the fences.
The bigger punches there were landed by Tommy.
And then that Kimura attempt, Caros Fodor almost had it, stepped over right at the last second here to get a little bit more leverage on it. Just so close, but that arm coming straight again ended up giving Tommy the inches he needed to really just kind of get a little space.
Okay, all day, Tommy. Okay.
Let's listen in.
I listen.
Out. Maya Ningram informing us that the second round is about to begin. Maya making her debut in and around the 1FC cage. We're all very happy to see her.
Carlos going Right back in it. Nice right hand.
He did swallow a big right hand, but he comes back with the knee. Seems very durable, doesn't he, the Korean?
He does. Tommy is trying to work the Muay Thai plum there. His hands around Carlos' neck.
Fodor very busy with those knees.
Couple of nice body shots, throwing an uppercut up the center there.
Goes upstairs and down with the right hand.
Some good dirty boxing inside by Caros.
They don't rest on their laurels, do they? Both men working hard as Yang gets pressed up on the cage now for the last 30, 40 seconds or so.
Staying nice and busy against the fence. Nice knee up the center. Looks like it just missed the face.
Tommy comes right back with one, though. By far the biggest stage.
Oh, he's got his back now.
That Tommy Young's fought on, and this is an opportunity for him.
And Carl did a good job there of keeping his back arched and turning in, getting wrist control. It shows you just the pedigree of Carlos.
You often talk about slippery bodies and how difficult it is to grasp your opponent. I think we're seeing that now so early in the second round.
Yeah, once you get sweat and things going too, it makes it very difficult to submit your opponent.
Uppercuts and right hands. Tommy Young felt those. They were good, clean shots from the American.
Carlos is doing a good job of working inside and keeping his head in the square in the center there. Doing a very good job, just picking his shots, putting him here his corner. Say, just put your hands on him. Just staying busy, open up those shots. And sometimes you trade shots to open up a position, trying to see how your opponent's going to react.
For the most part, you'd have to say that Fodor is the aggressor, but Tommy Young is showing some good durability and a great deal of heart.
Well, Tommy Young is very much still in this fight. I mean, I think he's getting weathered a little bit by some punches, but Carlos really hasn't let his hands go here. He's just kind of peppering him and throwing some small teasing shots in here. You saw him drop down on that double. Good knee right at the center. Nice elbow over the top.
The punches from Yang slightly more ragged than they were in the first few seconds of the contest. He's taken quite a battering, particularly from the knees, but Fodor's been busy with his hands as well, and it's got to start telling eventually. And an elbow to the face there.
Oh,
and
nice
that
left
rocked
hook.
Young. Fodor getting encouragement from his corner perpetually.
You know, one of the things, too, that you have to look at is people that are used to fighting. Oh, big right knee.
And the right hand. Yuji Shimada looking very carefully at that.
You guys that are used to fighting in the States and in other mixed martial arts promotions, they're kind of used to fighting to win rounds too, so the strategy is a little different when you come to ONE FC and the fight's gauged as a whole. You don't necessarily look at the fight the same way. You might think you won the first two rounds, but then your opponent finishes really strong and just that third round steals the fight for him. So it's very much more emulating a real fight with gloves in a cage.
Yeah, that little burst towards the end of the round, not so important at ONE FC.
Carl's doing a good job keeping good head pressure on Tommy there. Tommy really needs to switch to a double here and just get a big energy burst to pull Carl's legs off of the cage.
Oh, he's getting battered there from the left hand. Can't protect himself either. That's brutal. He's trying to lift up his opponent, is the Korean, but no success. He's so well planted, the American.
Well balanced, and also just takes a tremendous amount of energy out of you. The first round was just a frantic pace. Working for that Kimura on the far side.
Yeah, Young's face is taking some battering, and I think there's some blood there. It's bound to be bruised and bumped. He's taken a lot of punishment there. You can see now how tired he's starting to be. And I wonder if he's going to last much longer. Put in a great effort, but it looks like he'll survive this round. Only 5 seconds left of it, and I'd be interested to take a look at his face. I suspect that it'll be showing signs of the pummeling he's taken. Yes, indeed.
There's good action back and forth too in this round, and Caros came out swinging and got caught with a couple of shots and gave him right back to Tommy there. And then most of the action outside of this big right knee was right up against the cage. It looked like he had him rocked there for a few seconds, but Tommy was able to hang in there. Caros mixing it up with elbows, knees, and then peppering body shots have been the technique of the round.
On your time, create space, combination, hands, two knees, and then tie it back up, wherever you feel comfortable, okay? High volume, same thing. When he comes out, he's probably gonna come out swinging.
Yes, watch. Okay?
I will kill him.
Kill him, baby.
You kill him.
To the death, Tommy. To the death, okay?
All right, let's go. Go, 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 go.
Well, we get to see a round three, and so far I think that Caros is the less weathered of the two, and so far going into this has won the fight. Oh, flying knee just misses on Caros. And Caros content to go right back into the clinch here and keep working those body shots. Nice double leg. Tommy's protecting well. He really needs to forget about going to guard at this point, get to his knees and stand back up, because keeping the fight at this position means he's going to lose. And he really needs to kind of get in there and make something explosive happen and dig deep. Caros isolating that far arm. Tommy's got to be careful here because he's shown some flexibility with that left arm, but mixing up those punches and those elbows. Caros is going to look for some big shots to rain down here and just keeping a really good amount of pressure on Tommy. He's going to use his foot to pass guard here. He's going to kick his legs. Beautiful pass. Caros may look to take the back here. His corner's yelling at him to keep on top and do some damage. Well, Tommy really needs to find that extra step there, not go back to half guard and look for some sweeps, but he has to stand up, kind of throw punches to the fences at this point. Caros is doing a very good job of just controlling that constant head pressure, like you see there with Caros's left hand. Wherever your head goes, your body goes. So by pressing on your opponent's head and pushing him down, it makes it hard for him to sit up and get any posture. Caros just relentless with the pressure, not giving Tommy any time to work. Good work, staying busy. Staying nice and busy. Tommy looks a little bit more tired here than Caros is, but Caros is just keeping his body weight and pressure on him, mixing up those punches. Right back to the ground. Well, Caros is showing us why he went 5-0 in Strikeforce before hitting the bumps in the road against guys like Pat Healy and then Sam Stout in the UFC. But sometimes the best thing that happens to a fighter is you take a couple of losses. Might very well be the case here for Tommy if he doesn't get something going on the ground. Readjust to go back to the game plan and the drawing board. Carlos just raining down those elbows. His corner yelling for high volumes to stay busy. Carlos is looking to stay on top here. Tommy really needs a Hail Mary. He needs to separate and just throw some leather and hope that one of those lands on the button. There's a sweat factor playing in. Carlos just staying on you. When you have an opponent like that that just keeps constant pressure on you too, it breaks you mentally before it breaks you physically. Very difficult to get anything going here. And Carlos looking to finish strong. And he does.
So a fabulous three rounds we've seen. Fodor on his knees, surely has done enough to win. Very brave effort from Tommy Young.
Well, Tommy Young just missed with that flying knee. He thought that Carlos was gonna come out with a takedown, and Carlos was very dominant on the ground, trying to mix up the body shots.
Damage done. Damage done is one of the things that the judges will look at, and if you look at the two fighters' faces, it's Tommy Young that has been beaten up. What an effort he put in, though. Nobody said he could compete with this man, ex-UFC fighter, ex-Strikeforce fighter. Referee Yuji Shimada will raise the victor's hand, and surely it has to be Carlos Fodor.
Ladies and gentlemen, after three rounds, we go to the judges' scorecards. And all three judges see it for your winner via unanimous decision, fighting out of the blue corner, the future, Carlos Fodor!
And these punches should be extremely meaningful. First of all, though, a kick from Alain in the black trunks, Hassan in the pale blue. And if there is a violent takedown in this one, the whole stadium could rock. Oh, my word! A spinning kick that knocked Hassan straight down, and in comes the referee. Kenichi Serizawa didn't want to see any more of that, and I do not blame him. And look at Alain marching around the cage as if he owns it. This one was over so quickly that Jason Chambers didn't even get a word in.
Yeah, you're absolutely correct, Steve. Just making some notes, and I looked up there and caught that spinning back kick. That was just incredible. And that shows you the pedigree of a very high-level striker. It's so tremendously difficult to keep your balance and to have the whereabouts about landing those kicks, especially when you're 245 pounds of pure muscle.
Whoa, look at those biceps.
Sure, we're gonna be able to see that kick again here in a second. That was just absolutely on the money, and it rocked Hassan a little bit and put him off balance. You see here, Hassan set up a couple of punches. And Alain just grazed him right on the temple with that toe.
Seemed to get him around the temple, didn't it? Perhaps
let's take
just
a look
on
at
the top
from
of the
other
nose.
Side.
So rare that these are executed well enough. But yeah, high on the head, that one.
Perfect foot to the temple, and there's a few buttons, and that just put Hassan enough on crazy street to get a little rocked.
A disorienting shot. It seems to have landed high, but they're tending to Hassan's nose as he sits on the stool.
Ladies and gentlemen, referee Kenichi Serizawa calls a halt to this bout at 31 seconds of the very first round. For your winner, via referee stoppage. Due to strikes from the red corner, the Black Panther, Alain Ngalani.
Crouching style from the Evolve fighter Barros. Both men leading with their left hand. Very relaxed, the Australian looks. Just checking each other out in these early moments. A big overhand right comes in from Pham. It missed by an inch or so.
Well, Pham knows that Barros is going to look for that takedown and really try to exploit that submission game. So I think Pham was being a little bit patient, just trying to see what Barros is going to try to work to open those up. This is a dangerous submission or position, I should say. Being in the clinch here when you're still nice and dry. Barros gets Pham to the ground. This could be a long night for Pham. He needs to try to separate and put Barros on the cage. Throw some punches. Staying busy like that.
Big test for Barros. The first time he's competing professionally in mixed martial arts with a wealth of experience in BJJ behind him.
See, Barros' head's a little bit low to the side there. He's got to be careful as he can catch a knee to the face.
I think he's taken something to the groin there, probably a knee. Yeah. Need a little bit of a timeout. Not well greeted by the audience here at the Astora Senayan.
It happens.
I, for one, have some sympathy.
Now, even though the fighters wear cups, everything is packed neatly. You shake the box around and you're going to have damaged goods.
I think we get the picture. But he didn't take the full 5 minutes that was available to him and just got clocked on the jaw there with a right hand from Pham. It was a wisping kind of shot, didn't do any great damage. He's got quick hands though, hasn't he, the Australian?
Well, he has to get inside. It looks like he's got an inch or two less reach than Barros has, and I think that Pham needs to keep pressing the action, but he has to be careful when he walks forward like that, throwing punches. If Pham's going to try to time those punches, get underneath, and get that takedown or clinch up again, so really needs to kind of utilize that jab, stay outside of the lead leg, so that he doesn't give too much space for that takedown.
Again, Barros came within an inch of really taking a big right hand.
And the longer this fight goes on too, the more sweat that builds up, the harder it's gonna be for Barros to get that takedown. So he wants to try to secure this early in the round here.
Fan is using that right knee to the inside of Barros's left leg.
That's something that BJ Penn does a lot too. He puts the shin across your hip, trying to keep your weight away a little bit and also stop the takedown. But he's also giving Pham the leg. A lot of times guys will take that bait, drop down, and try to get a single, depending on how confident they are in their wrestling.
That target area, though, desperately close to a foul shot, and we've seen one of those already.
And Barros has got an inside leg. He's going to try to trip and turn to the right.
Resilient to being taken down so far, the Australian.
So far, so good. The longer the fight goes on, the more I think it's going to lean in Pham's favor, because he definitely looks a little more the busy striker, looks a little bit more confident on his feet, even though a couple of his punches have fallen short. He knows that Barros is really wanting to get this into his comfort zone, get on the ground as quickly as he can and really get in there and try to work the submission game.
It may be a BJJ black belt against the purple belt, but purple belts know what they're doing.
Yeah, and the difference too with Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu and black belt, white belt, is when you have a gi on, there's dramatic differences when you have all these extra handles and things you can grab onto, which is primarily the way the most Jiu-Jitsu guys start out. And that's great because it gives you balance and things like that. But once you take that gi top off, you lose a lot of the things that you're used to, a lot of the sleeves and the collars you hold onto. So a lot of the techniques that you have, if you train them a specific way, they lose a lot of their value. The attributes you take with you, the speed, the timing, the defense, and things like that. But purple belt to black belt no-gi is very different. Even black belt to high-level world champion black belt is very different.
Pham is having the best of it in the stand-up. His punches are quite telegraphed, but he's landed with one or two in the last minute there. notably a right hand just 10 or 15 seconds ago.
I think Pham knows that Barros wants to press the action and look for the clinch, so he might want to start working some punches and some knees up the center. Just like that, he's pushing forward, getting that clinch where he feels nice and safe, and try to work for the takedown again. Got to be careful reaching for that knee like that, though, because he could eat one to the face, even though he's hoping to eat one a little bit and kind of take a glancing shot in order to get the takedown.
Final 10 seconds of this round, and Pham comes in with a couple of right hands high on the head of the Brazilian. Pham looking over in his corner just to see if he can pick up some advice in the final moments there. Perhaps it's that man who edges that first round. Don't forget, 1FC contests judged over the entirety of the fight. Heath Sims asking Barros to initiate. Just to clarify, when I said earlier on that the judging is over the entirety of the fight, we don't have round by round scoring here.
Uses his punches really well to set up that takedown. That's what Barros needed to do from the get-go. Just getting Pham enough to respect his hands to open that takedown up. You see a lot of guys sometimes have very unique striking or very good grappling, but if they're not able to get your opponent to respect the other avenues that they can attack you with, it's very hard to utilize those things. Barros is going to try to peel Pham away from the cage here and put his back flat on the mat. He's going to hook the legs, try to step over into mount and take away the base. And Pham on the opposite side wants to use that cage to wall walk, start getting his feet underneath him and stand back up, push on the head a little bit. It's kind of a 50-50 position here.
Yeah, with that cage behind him, Pham not really interested in taking that neck, using his hands instead to punch the body of the Brazilian. Now, given his back up.
Let's see if Barros feels comfortable to jump to the back here. Sometimes guys like to get the hooks in right away and jump to the back. He's thinking about it. You saw him try to work that leg in a little bit. Got to be careful, though, because if he jumps to the back and misses, all your body weight's up. Yeah. Slide off and lose position.
Vulnerable to that left elbow, which is why he's tucking his head into the right there, as he does again. No leverage for Pham to elbow with his right arm pressed up against the cage as he is.
Well, Pham needs to really turn hard to his left and use that cage to kind of scrape Barros off his back so he can face him and get wrist control right away, because if he doesn't have wrist control, it's going to be very difficult for him to do anything here.
There's a big effort from Barros there to get that position.
And Barros on the back now. This is a very bad position for you to be in when most of your losses have come by submission. You've got a Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu black belt riding you.
And Heath Sims just over his back there beyond the cage advising at very close quarters.
Pham needs to get wrist control, go 2-on-1. Stop worrying about punching him in the head here. Really needs to get his position down before he worries about striking. Position's key in MMA. Right now, you're in a very bad position. He either needs to stand up, start peeling those hooks off, but he's got to keep his chin tucked because Pham's trying to make sure that Barros doesn't work his right arm underneath his chin and start working those. There he goes, nice. That's what he needs to do, face him and stand back up.
And appreciation at cage side from this knowledgeable crowd in Jakarta, Indonesia.
Watch out.
So constantly looks very composed, Kian Pham.
That's one of the things that's great about jiu-jitsu is that you guys can use the upper body and lower body independently. He's using his leg there to trip him even though he's still got the upper body lock. And you see at very high levels of jiu-jitsu, guys can keep pressure down with their chest or with their legs and use the other part of their bodies almost completely independently. So a lot of balance and a lot of time, just putting in numbers, drilling and drilling, getting better and better.
Phan with his feet on the cage, trying to find as much leverage as he can. You can't grip the cage with your hands anyway, but he's doing a pretty good job of doing that with his toes.
You know, Phan can actually run up the cage here to the left and create enough leverage where he could roll Barros off, but I don't think that's what he's looking to do here. He needs to be very careful extending those arms. Again, when a guy like Phan is on the bottom here and you see him holding on to Barros on the top, he's just trying to stalemate him out a little bit here.
3 5-minute rounds of this contest. We're in the final minute of the second round.
Center.
Good top control showed by Barros here.
Action!
Phan's corner's yelling at him to push off of that fence.
He's got his foot locked in the door there, just freed it.
Barros really needs to create some space here.
Oh, he did well.
Nice, good reversal.
Tremendous strength of the torso to do that. 30 seconds left.
That's one of the differences, too, between jiu-jitsu and MMA. Jiu-jitsu is very methodical and has very slow-paced movements, especially when you're training in the gi. And then in MMA, you have these explosive movements that tend to pay off dividends.
Phan clearly wanting the fight to come back on its feet. And Barros having to oblige as we come into the final 10 seconds of this second round. An enthralling contest it is too. And if Phan had the better of round one, perhaps Barros had the better of round two, Jason.
Yeah, that's tough. I think that actually, you know, that Barros is probably up so far in the fight. I mean, you saw that Barros was able to get the back here, started to work some submission, softened him up a little bit, but even though he was on top, Phan exploded and was able to get and start working into half guard here and pass. Would have been nice to see what Phan had on top, but have to wait for the next round to see where this goes.
Yeah, you gotta be active, you gotta be moving. Don't be lazy against the fence. You got lazy at the end, you know, you let him get the second takedown for free. All right, you gotta work, you gotta be active there, okay? You gotta in the tank, how do you feel? You feel good? A couple of deep breaths, make slow ride down.
Okay, next time you don't cut, okay?
Second down, please.
Third and final round then. That the last time that Phan's corner men will be able to give him instruction at such close quarters. There's plenty of coaching going on while they're fighting though. Phan breathing quite hard between rounds there. A tap of gloves. Very customary in this sport. Tremendous respect that fighters tend to have for each other.
The leg kick was a little sloppy by Barros. He's got to be careful. If Phan starts to realize that, he knows that Barros wants to shoot for that takedown, so he might want to use that to his advantage and try to draw him into a battle where he thinks he can open that up.
Phan hasn't got the biggest of reaches, and he does fall short sometimes, but he does clip Barros there with a right hand.
You know, if I'm Phan at this point, I don't want to stay here and try to play the pummel game and put my opponent against the cage. If I do spin him and put him against the fence, I'm going to try to put both hands on the chin and break away and create space, because being on the bottom against a jiu-jitsu black belt, even if you're comfortable there, it's not your best position. Your best chance to win the fight is utilizing the striking advantage that you have here.
Look at the drive that Barros is putting in there.
He's working a far side Kimura. Guys like Carl Parisian used to be great at this. Guys would get in on single legs wrestlers and they just lock up that forearm and toss you, throw you over the top with it.
Elbows to the head, and again, such a damaging blow that can be, especially to the temple there as those two did come in.
Jiu-jitsu guys are usually compared to anacondas because they're very methodical, and it's you get a position, they creep up a couple more inches, they get another position, they stay on you, they don't give you any room to breathe, and we're seeing that with Barros here. He's not taking a lot of chances when he's on the ground. He's not opening up and throwing a bunch of haymakers. He's not trying to get in these scramble positions. He's just trying to slowly advance, be methodical. If he sees a punch, he's going to take it just like that. Working the knee over belly, going to try to move into mount here. just slow and methodical.
Pure jiu-jitsu fighters, though, not used to taking elbows to the head, are they? And that's what Farmer's looking to do there, trying all he can to just try and free himself from these clutches or get an advantageous position.
Farmer needs to get his hands on his hips and try to get to his left side. He doesn't want to be flat on his back here. He's even got his guard open. He's not even holding half guard, really. It's going to be very easy for Barros to pass if he realizes that that leg isn't locked. Barros is going to start using that right instep to push down on Fahm's thigh, and he's going to slowly squeak that left leg out and look to move into mount or pass into cross side.
Clock to finish.
Out of your picture, Yuji Shimada. Very close to the action, talking to them, telling them what he wants from them.
Well, I think refs is just calling for action because even though Barros is in control here, he has to look to improve his position or do some damage. You can't just lay on your opponent in this position and be happy with that. You know, the onus is on you that if you're on top and you're the advantage position, you have to still be looking to do more with it.
Inside the final 2 minutes, Barros looks to have the edge here. What can Farm do to take it away from him?
Well, Farm needs to make some explosion happen here. He's not going to be able to play jiu-jitsu with a jiu-jitsu black belt. He needs to take his feet on the hips and start creating some space, kick off, put the shin across the hips. For instance, being in guard right here, I don't think is the best decision for him because he's just kind of holding on to Barros here, hoping that you know, he's going to take away the base and maybe the referee will stand him up, start up-kicking and getting your knees. But when you've got a guy like Barros on top of you, he's just going to really keep solid, solid pressure. Judo, wrestling, jiu-jitsu, they're all about very good pressure and using your body weight and dexterity.
Yeah,
not a lot of wasted movement here. It's good economy of motion.
Let's go.
The crowd responding to Lenny Hart's call there for the final minute. It needs a great deal from Farm now. Started the fight well, but since then, it's gone down to the mat where Barros is most comfortable. And his black belt credentials coming to the fore.
Farm has Barros in butterfly guard now, and then started to get a little elevation there. Right to the back like a ninja. Barros smelled that back like a dog smells meat. Oh, looking for a little ankle lock action here.
Running out of time to do anything with it.
10 seconds left. Barros is probably just going to finish this with a few punches, play it really safe.
It's been a good effort from Farm, and he looks to end it in a spectacular way. But too little, too late, I'm afraid. It looks to me as if Barros has won this one on points. It'll go to the judges. Yes, certainly. Certainly, Farm could be proud of his performance and what he's done there in his 1FC debut. But as Leandro Issa comes to give his teammate a warm embrace, I think we're looking at the winner.
Well, this match kind of went the way we thought it was going to be. I think that Barros is probably going to come away with the W on this one. Played a very methodical game. Set up the takedown with his punches. He did exactly what I think anyone in his corner would tell him to do. Is, you know, it's your first fight, play to your strengths. And if you take a look here, there was some back and forth action closer to the end of the round where Barros had a little bit of a scramble. It was a little too late from Fahm, kind of turn up the heat at the last few seconds, throwing punches. Punches came up just a little bit short here.
Just been doused in water, and he'll welcome that.
Leandro Issa and Heath in the corner, excellent training partners.
So is the debutant about to extend his record to 1-0? He thinks so, and so do we. Let's see. Anthony Suntai with the official decision.
Ladies and gentlemen, after three rounds, we go to the judges' scorecards, and all three judges see it for your winner. Via unanimous decision, fighting out of the blue corner, Almiro Barros!
Malaysia in the blue and black trunks. Indonesia in the red.
Majid's just looking like he's kind of being very pensive, focused, trying to close the distance. Tan to it through a couple of wild punches. Looks a little tentative here. Crowd loves it when Majid goes in for any strikes. Definitely a fan favorite here. Like you talked about, Indonesia versus Malaysia. Not going to win a lot of fans when you talk about I'm instinctually better because I'm from Malaysia. But.
And Majid's early target, clearly the leg. Oh, what a shot! It countered that leg strike, and it did the damage. He's composed himself, Tan. But it was a huge right hand over the top. It was the third leg kick that had been thrown.
Right away, Majid is working on that far side Kimura. This is where Majid is really at home here. Blue belt in jiu-jitsu, judo background. He's locking it up, and there's no sweat. There's a lot of ability to get a submission here. Majid really needs to get that Kimura set correctly and get his right elbow on the ground, because when you have guys' arms off the ground and they're flailing around.
Oh, that looks awful. Oh, and it was just too awful. He came through that first test, didn't he? Of taking the boxer's punch and then took charge on the mat, putting that arm in a position that nobody wants it. And it's judo and BJJ that wins out in a first round submission victory for the homeboy in front of his compatriots.
Well, he looks calm and collected the whole time, even though he did eat a right hand there when he threw that kick. Just very calm. You see right here, Tan throws that right hand, it lands on the button. It was hard to tell if he actually got rocked there, if that was just a balance situation, but Majid was able to get to a double leg really quick and get underneath Tan. And you see here when he works into cross side, he's finally able to just wrench that elbow all the way to the left, create enough torque to put all the pressure on that shoulder lock here.
Ladies and gentlemen, referee Kenichi Serizawa calls a halt to this battle at a minute 30 seconds of the very first round. For your winner by submission via key lock from the red corner, Vincent Jackhammer Majid.
Both men in the orthodox style. The first kick comes in from Bruno.
And Bruno said he wants to stand, try feel how his stand-up feels here, so this is going to be interesting to see how long he's willing to commit to that. We saw Bashir in 1FC before. He's very tenacious, very hungry.
Tit for tat early on, but Bashir eats the stronger punch there, the right hand. But it was the kick from Bashir that felled his opponent. And now the Brazilian has to show his mettle.
This is the time to do it, like we talked about. Bashir is still relatively dry. Bruno's going to have a good opportunity here to keep his grip on Bashir and try to go for the takedown. Bashir, like you said, is very smart. You know, a lot of times people think that because people fight, that doesn't necessarily reflect the intelligence level. You have a lot of teachers, a lot of super intelligent guys getting there because it's really a chess match. Beautiful double leg.
It was a heavy fall as well. Bashir broke it with his left hand and may even have hurt his left hand slightly. Came from a long way up.
And Bashir's got to be careful here on his back. Got to work out of the half guard here. Now this is where we get to see the difference in a blue belt on his back with a black belt on top. Bashir made the comment that MMA isn't jiu-jitsu. Bashir's doing now is just kind of holding on. You see guys kind of try to stalemate guys by just holding on to the waist there, looking for a stand-up. And and puts a lot of pressure on you when you're on top. You have to keep that movement going because the last thing you want to do is get an advantageous position and get stood up again and have to eat some shots.
Strong, isn't he, Bashir, on the floor? He put both shoulder blades down there, constantly putting pressure on the man that's on top of him.
Bashir's doing the right thing. He's trying to get up and not just lay there and keep his hands underneath. Got to be careful now. He's in crucifix.
And eating punches and elbows, or forearms at least.
Come on, Bashir.
You're Bashir's corner yelling to pummel and get his underhook, which is what he needs to do. Bruno's got good head and arm control. He's going to start to attack that forearm and work to free up position. Bruno's advancing to the back now. Bashir's going to try to turn and face him, protecting his neck.
Busy with his hands, Bruno, which is good to see. Not everyone thinks about that when you've done so much BJJ and got so far in that sport.
You definitely got to control the neck. The first thing you want to do is when a guy's on your back, is tuck your chin, shrug your shoulders up. Oh, this is tight. It's around the chin, though. It doesn't look like it's necessarily underneath enough. He needs to grab that top hand of Bruno and start peeling it down.
Oh, it's tipped out. Well, it didn't look as if he'd got underneath that chin at all, but clearly the chin was being pressed into the head, and that's painful. And you can understand Bashir calling it a day. And what a great 1FC debut that is for the new guy at Evolve MMA. Bruno Pucci, the Pucci Bull. Extends his record to 3-0, comes across the cage to pay his respect to Pakistan's main man. And we'll see more of Bashir Ahmad, but we'll also see more of this man. Quick victory will do an awful lot for his CV. With the backing of Evolve, he could go a very long way. Good-looking young man, will be very popular. Got a bit of blood underneath his eye, not clear whether that's from him. But you've got to expect to take a little bit of punishment in this game. And Bashir did get through with a couple of good punches. Here's Anthony Suntai.
Ladies and gentlemen, referee Yuji Shimada calls a halt to this bout at 3:13 of the very first round. For your winner, by submission, via rear naked choke, out of the blue corner, it's Bruno Pucci Bull!
Could be a fast start. Butler goes for the takedown.
Kouame smelled that out, knew right away that Butler was gonna shoot for that double leg.
Certainly did.
But you know, it doesn't necessarily mean that because he didn't get it right away that he won't be able to sink it in on his second or third attempt. You know for sure that Kouame's been working with wrestlers in his camp. Has to have been able to see footage of Jake Butler's last two fights. No, Jake goes for the shot almost right off the bat. And if he can keep Jake's shot off the bat, you know, keep him off of the mat, it's going to give him a lot of confidence.
One of the problems for Butler as he trains is to train with people who are as physically big as he is. Now, Kouame has the advantage of being able to train with his brothers. And I wonder if that'll tell here.
Big slam.
And again, back and front.
The belly to back suplex, and then Jake works around right now, getting his hooks in. Gonna get to see how he works off of the back of Kouame here. But Kwame's still doing a good job as far as defending. He knows what Jake wants to do. And then the longer the fight goes.
And that will have knocked the wind out of Butler. These two men so big when they hit the canvas. It shakes, believe me. Jason and I are sitting right at the edge.
Kouame needs to control the wrist of Jake Butler here and try to turn and face him. Might try to stand up and get the hooks in, but this is a bad position for him to be in. Jake Butler's finished his last two opponents by getting mounted and just raining down strikes.
Forearms, fists. He's covering up Kouame as best he can. Very well, actually.
good bump. Kouame needs to get Jake down. Jake is really high up underneath Kwame's armpits, and that creates a lot of leverage. Kouame needs to start bumping his hips, or else the referee is going to come in there and stop it.
Yeah, like a bucking bronco. He needs to get rid of Jake Butler there because too many punches are coming down. Covering up well, but not throwing anything back.
Jake could...
Oh, and he's tapped.
Tapped to a head.
It must have been the left arm around the neck. Not an easy one to see that, but I suspect it was the arm choke, the left arm around the throat there. And it didn't take Kouame long to realize that that was the end of his night. Jake Butler moves from strength to strength. He Sims has a nice broad smile. He's 3-0 now, all of his fights in the 1FC cage. You know, he's a story right around the world, this man. He's been in the New York Post. Quite a lot of New York media are interested in this fella. Locally in Singapore and right around Asia, there's a lot of interest in Jake Butler, and that's only going to increase. The power and technique of an NCAA wrestler. Division One, no less. Comes to the fore. And James Kouame will have to deal with another day. Here's Anthony Suntai.
Ladies and gentlemen, referee Yuji Shimada calls a halt to this bout at 2 minutes, 11 seconds of the very first round for your winner via submission from the blue corner, Jake Butler!
Across the torso. Got a big high guard there, leading with his left hand. Latour leads with his right and sent in a straight left there to open festivities. Good right left from Willy there, and he clubs Latour on the back of the head.
Latour's having a hard time finding his range, just kind of leaping in there with that right hand, that left hand.
Scored a couple of times with it, just as you were speaking, Jason, but glancing blows.
Yeah, but he's leaving it out there, too, and it's given Knee the opportunity to come in and just come over the top with a couple shots. See how he leaves it out there? He's bringing it back to his hip when he throws it. He's not bringing it straight out and straight back.
He is scoring, though, and it's up to Willy Knee to see if he can counter. What he needs is Jason Chambers in his corner. Oh, knee to the head. That was brutal from Latoel. And down went Willy.
Good to see Willy's butterfly guard now. Latoel's got a little bit of a front guillotine. I don't know if he has enough pressure here to really finish it, though. And he's giving up a little bit of position to try to finish. Oh, that's
it. He did it.
Caught it.
A great deal of effort put into that. Vincent Latoel, you could see the grimace on his face as he was taking that hold and struggling to keep it within his grip, but it all paid off. And Willy Knee is a shocked and extremely disappointed man. He's just beaten the canvas with his fist, doesn't want to take, he's just pushed Melvin Manoff away, doesn't want to take any sympathy at all. My goodness, he's an angry young man. Respectfully so, I'm quite sure, but he's disgusted with himself. And meanwhile, Vincent Latoel does multiple laps of honor, goes over to see his opponent. How will this go down? Well, as you might expect, very, very well. Good sportsmanlike behavior from Willy, who needed a moment just to get over that. You could see the anger. Oh, his moment came, and just like that it went. But Latoel is a very happy fella. And let's not forget, it's a win for Indonesia.
Ladies and gentlemen, referee Kenichi Serizawa calls a halt to this battle at a minute, 25 seconds of the very first round for your winner by submission via guillotine choke from the red corner, Vincent Latou.
Colossa in the black trunks, Boku in the yellow. Good head movement from Boku. Dancing around the outside of the cage. Colossa taking the center of the ring here. Just feeling each other out.
Well, both guys have tremendous respect for each other's striking prowess. It's a very difficult match to call too, because you know this, they match up very evenly on paper. Kotetsu is a little more of a boxer, a little more of an in-your-face brawler. Vuyisile, a little more of a technical striker. But again, the edge and experience and against tough vets goes to Boku. Boku's fought and beaten some UFC vets like Hermes Franca and Mijusaka.
You may remember that when Boku fought Zorobabel Moreira, he took a heap of punishment to the thigh. And the only meaningful punishment that's been dealt out so far is Colossa kicking that thigh. Clearly saw that fight and feels he might have learned something from it.
Well, I think that's smart. You know, Boku has more of an orthodox boxing style. Light on his feet, moves really well. I'm surprised that Colossa's not working that leg more to kind of see if he ever found an answer to it.
It's all about the kicks from Vuyisile at the moment.
Boku does a really good job of finding his range early in fights. He's got great footwork. I mean, if you want to watch a great boxer, look at Boku's footwork here. I mean, he's just fantastic the way that he moves. And even though he keeps his hands a little bit lower than most people recommend, he's just got impeccable timing.
But he's got that one-punch power, hasn't he? And he just threw that right hand there that gave you a glimpse of it. Landed a touch short.
Vuyisile looks like he's having a little bit of a difficult time setting up and finding his rhythm here.
Don't think he's landed a punch yet, but clearly going to work on those thighs that have been exposed before.
Well, Fusude is an explosive striker, so when he comes in, he's going to come in with a bunch of punches. Kotetsu's a little more methodical and likes to pick his shots. Ooh, shin to shin.
Don't like that.
It hurts.
As you've pointed out, though, Jason, already such a good mover, isn't he, Boku? He's springy. We'll see if that lasts the full 15 minutes. But he's full of energy.
Well, Boku right now is just kind of setting up his timing off of Colossa. Colossa's pumping that jab out there a lot, but not really finding a rhythm or a range.
The inside of the leg kick there from Vuyisile, the South African. Crowd getting a bit restless here at cage side. Oh, the right hand came over from Kotetsu. I wonder if Yuji Shimada will just ask them to mix it up a little bit more. They're both very cautious at the moment, particularly with the hands. Neither wanting to get in range to the point where they're super exposed. Each having great respect for the opponent. Good right hand from Boku, and that caught Colossa.
You know, one of the things that you see in boxing and mixed martial arts is that guys don't tend to get hit when they're playing defense and moving around. They take more punishment when they start throwing those punches, and a guy like Boku, you know, he's going to try to draw you in and see what you're going to do and open up those shots. Colossus isn't really as much of a counterpuncher. He just like comes in and kind of overwhelms guys with a flurry and mixes up his punches and his levels well.
Well, 4 minutes of this contest gone, and you probably give the edge to Vuyisile at the moment just because of the leg kicks.
I don't know. I think I'd give it to Boku. I think he's been more definitive. He's landed a couple more shots as far.
Well, there you are. That's how close it is. Jason and I split. It's an intriguing one, that's for sure.
But, you know, that may be the first kick I've ever seen Boku throw. You know, that there's a lot of camps, though, that, you know, they know this is a three-round fight, and the fans want to see quick, fast, aggressive, get in there and knock the guy's head off. But this is how, you know, these guys make a living. And what's important is coming away with the win and putting together a good game plan and how are you going to dismantle your opponent and, you know, what's the best way to beat this guy is really important. There's a lot of teams like Greg Jackson's that You know, they put together great game plans, and it's a slower, more methodical pace, but they come away with the win consistently.
Well, it's a chess match, isn't it, in this first round, which is coming to an end. Good work from Vuyisile with the leg kicks, no question about that. If we're talking about punches, Boku was the one that got through. Just take us through some of these highlights, Jason.
Well, it was a little bit of a trade-off there. Boku timed that right hand from Cincinnati all the way over to train tracks and landed right on the chin of Colossa, and then Colossa countered back with that lead left hook that he's known for. So can Colossa connect more? Will Boku put lights out? You have to find out.
But I like that. You're missing it. Follow with that. Right hand. Walk your right hand. You're missing it. Follow that. Nice. Deep breathe. Deep breathe.
Outside low kick.
The hole in the back.
Well, Vuyisile's corner man encouraging him to throw with the right hand. And I think they were looking for him to be a bit of a body snatcher as well. Felix here, yep.
When you fight a guy like Boku, though, who's so comfortable on the outside, and he's finding his rhythm. His corner, I think, Vuyisile's corner needs to see that and tell him to get in his face more. Don't let him set that rhythm up. You got to kind of force the brawl a little bit.
Vuyisile just walking around the cage there, if I'm reading it correctly, may have hurt his left foot or his left leg. Seemed to be limping slightly. Now, Boku, I think, took a punch but probably slipped.
I think he just slipped on the canvas. You know, that shin-to-shin contact earlier really can be painful, and that'll swell up some welts. You know, if I'm in Vuyisile's corner, I'm going to tell him to start working that thigh, just like we saw Zoro Moreira have a lot of success with.
It's become a target, hasn't it, for
Boku? He keeps trying to work the inside leg kick, but he keeps getting caught with that straight right hand that Crazy B keeps throwing down the center. He's just so fast. You see that Crazy B's catching him with the jab all the way down from his hip, too.
How about that jab? It's snappy, isn't it? We haven't seen so much of it, but he's exhibiting it in this round. Again, Vuyisile works the thigh.
And if you ever watch Bruce Lee's movement, he was very light on his feet. Was very, very, had very good movement, very boxing-like, and I think that Kotetsu kind of emulates that a lot. Has that loose style, light on his feet. Great with judging his timing.
Kick coming up to the midriff there from Colossa. Had to take a punch, though.
You know, Velasa's not really turning his hips over on that kick either. He's kind of just winging it out there, and his hips are pretty square. I'd like to see him get his head off the center and turn his hips over a little bit more on that.
And there's certainly a pattern here. I'm looking at the inside of Boku's left knee, and it's very red. Taken a lot of punishment there, and higher up as well. And if it's anything like the fight with Zoro, he's going to be struggling as this fight goes on. He's a marked man around those legs. More ways than one.
And the kick that connects. Kotetsu just throws that long range shot. Very accurate with it. It was a nice knee by Vuyisile.
Well, he led with his face there, Boku. He thought he was going to throw a punch, decided against it, and found himself pretty exposed. Vuyisile is doing a pretty good job of cutting him off now. Very, very red and sore, that left leg.
Well, halfway through the fight, it's difficult to really gauge this far. Not a ton of discernible damage done by either guy.
Boku's starting to blow. The older man, remember, 36 years old. Colossus 31. Oh, there it is.
That's a nice kick in the thigh. It's probably the best one he's connected with. He set that up with his hands. That was what I think he needs to do with Boku, is he found what's working and stay on that. That 1-2 and then pow, with the right leg. Boku keeps lunging in with closing his distance.
Has Zorobabel Moreira shown Vuyisile how to beat this man? Not that Zoro managed it, because don't forget, Boku has this tremendous punching power that saved him against the Brazilian in Singapore. And who's to say it won't do the same again here in Jakarta?
Well, not a lot of urgency to get this fight done by either guy right now. I think Boku feels comfortable working the outside and outboxing Vuyisile, and Vuyisile feels like he keeps connecting just like that with that leg kick. He's going to wear him down. And, oh, nice left hand by Vuyisile.
And he trots after him. Keen to get the job done now, Vuyisile. Oh, left and right and left and knee to the midriff. And this is good work from the South African. What can Boku pull out of the bag under a little bit of pressure? Solid left jab from Colossa.
Nice,
and again the leg and the right hand followed up. And Kotetsu is looking slightly more the weary man.
And Vuyisile really looks like he's found his rhythm here, and Kotetsu is kind of having a hard time picking that back up. That first round was all Kotetsu mixing it up, but now it's been Vuyisile with the tie clinch and then just really connecting with that right kick, right hand combo.
He's found his timing, hasn't he, Vuyisile?
He has. He's found his distance, I think, more than anything. He's landed these shots really nice.
Oh, hands down below the waist. Come on then, hit me and I'll counter you, is the message he's sending.
You know, every time that Vuyisile has gone first, he's had a lot more success getting Boku on his back heels and backing up. You can't throw effective strikes just like that when you're backing up and your weight's on the back of your feet.
Oh. The big overhand right from Boku did not land. If it did, it just brushed the beard of the South African. Two rounds in the book. Remember, we don't score round by round. It's how the judges feel about the overall contest. I asked you a few moments ago who you thought was winning, Jason. Who do you think's winning now?
Well, at this point, I've got to give it to Vuyisile. I think he's done more damage up until this point of the fight. And we've seen that Kotetsu's backpedaled a lot. And every time that Vuyisile has thrown combinations and followed it up with a kick, he's been very successful. You know, here you see the same thing. Pow!
Lays
that kick in low.
He was coming, didn't he, Boku, there? He's wary of it. That leg's hurting.
He's finding his range and his distance, you know, and I think that if Vuyisile just stays on that, using his hands, Kotetsu isn't a very good counterpuncher. And when you put him on his heels and his weight on his back legs, it makes it difficult for him to strike. Kotetsu has to get off first. If you respect his hands, he's going to connect with a bunch of punches. But when Vuyisile puts the pressure on, he really takes the lead.
He's got that graze on his nose, and he just saw it on the big screen and was looking up at it. Gave it a bit of a poke. Well, you and I were having a drink of orange juice in the hotel bar yesterday evening, and Kotetsu was there drinking water, just acclimatizing himself to the time of the evening that this fight would be contested. Such a lovely fella. He's the kind of fella that you want as your good friend. The same could be said of Vuyisile Colossa. Two fine men, two fine warriors. And the chess match continues, round three.
You know, Boku has a very solid ground game. I wouldn't be surprised if he tried to open it up here and look for a takedown and kind of explore if that route's going to be a little bit more open for him, especially when he takes all this punishment on his legs.
And he's really taking punishment now.
Yeah, the left side of Boku's left leg is just swollen up.
You don't want to spin around like that in front of Vuyisile. He's got quick hands. Didn't take that opportunity, though.
Right now, it looks like the cheetah is hunting an antelope.
Kotetsu's been thinking about dropping down a weight, and you'd think that that would suit him. Oh, but he's taking punishment now.
He's really connecting with those shots. You can see it's taking a toll on Boku. He's trying to run away and disengage while he gets the lactic acid out of his legs.
How many times does a South African watch that tape of the Zorro fight?
Oh, he's connecting. I mean, that's what we talked about. That first round was very slow and methodical, and that very well could be part of Vuyisile's game plan overall to see how Boku's going to react.
And his Muay Thai background leading to those knees to the midriff. Kotetsu Boku, the former ONE FC lightweight champion, is under pressure. His back quite literally to the cage. And figuratively speaking, he's got something to do here.
Well, Boku has to be careful with his head way off to the side like that, because Vuyisile is very long. He can throw a knee right up to the noggin there.
Important for Vuyisile not to get complacent, because the power of that punch,
nice double tie kick,
could be so destructive. But he looks focused, chin down, tucked in.
And another nice 10 to the leg. You know, Vuyisile's starting to see a pattern here, that when he sets up those hands, he's just, takes the back.
Well.
This could be an interesting position here.
Here's a turn.
Boku gets him to the ground. It's kind of a takedown. I think Boku was working to the back there and really just kind of lost position, but Haven't seen Boku on his back yet. This is going to be interesting to see how he works from this position out of that the fight.
Taking punishment.
And Vuyisile wants it back up. Boku just hasn't really been able to find a solution. You see, every time Boku starts circling left, Vuyisile cuts him off with that kick. Right there. And as soon as he starts to circle into it again, he gets hit with that kick. Vuyisile is moving him left with his left hand and his right hand. Big two, lunging punch.
2.25 minutes left, and it looks as if Boku is running out of time to unleash that bomb of his. Vuyisile has been disciplined. He's stuck to his game plan, and he's executed it perfectly well so far.
Yeah, Boku looks really tired now, too. I think that if Vuyisile just moved in and just put some combinations together, he could really score. You know, unless he just feels very confident that he's got this fight in the bag. He's engaging in, you know, 1-2-3-B combos, but if he really just put together a flurry or 8-9, I think he could really hurt Boku here. Boku's just kind of taking his time and getting his energy back, and you don't want to give your opponent who's running away from you that time. In the words of Karate Kid, finish him. Oh, big shot to the knee. Oh, nice shot to Boku's chin.
Here it comes, and another knee to the head.
Oh, these are connecting good. Boku's never be finished.
He could be finished now. The elbow coming down, the knee. Yuji Shimada's watching carefully. There's nothing coming back. He turns his back on him. He's got a minute to survive. Well, like hands on hips.
Like we just talked about, like to see a flurry or something there. And he really had Boku on the ropes. Boku just looks really tired. You know, Vuyisile is either a great actor or else he has a lot more energy right now. And I don't see why you wouldn't get in there.
Well, he told me he just ran out of gas against Tenanis. And that's why he wasn't able to defend that submission late on. He looks fresh enough to do the job here. 40 seconds remaining. Colossa on top. Boku is gripping now.
You know, Vuyisile has just thrown all those kicks low, and Boku's hands are so low. I think if he just throws one right to the head of Boku, he could connect with that. Boku's got to get his hands up and feel some urgency here. Clearly, he's tired in this fight, but backpedaling and running away isn't going to win you any fans, and it's not going to win you any money in a win purse either. So.
Well, you called it, Jason. He's not winning fans right now. He tried a couple of Hail Mary-type overhand rights. There's the big left. But it's too little, too late, I fancy, for the Japanese. Just ate a knee to the kisser. And Vuyisile has redeemed himself, surely, in the 1FC cage. He knows it. I fancy Boku knows it. Takes his customary end-of-fight position, sitting down on the floor. Vuyisile Colossa had an up-and-down time of it in 1FC. But against a former lightweight champion, this victory, if indeed it comes, will do him a great deal of good.
Well, there wasn't a ton of action back and forth, but right here with that front kick, and then when he finally puts those combinations together against Boku, that was really close to being the end of the fight. Boku was defending most of these shots, and I would have started throwing some uppercuts here, but elbows from hell, knees coming from all angles. And I think that this flurry here may have been enough in the judges' eyes to make them feel like he really wanted to finish that fight, and most of the damage was done there.
It was desperate times in the final seconds. And Boku sitting down, having a chat with Vuyisile, who lifts him to his feet. Great respect from these two great fighters. Very entertaining stuff it was. We've yet to get the formal decision, but it's looking very like a win for the South African.
Ladies and gentlemen, after three rounds, we go to the judges' scorecards. And all three judges see it for your winner via unanimous decision. From the red corner, Vuyisile, the cheetah, Colossal!